I guess it's happening right now. Hello, everybody. This is week two of Grinding with Claude Von Stroke. I am your host, Claude Von Stroke, of course. I'm the owner of Dirty Bird, and we're going to talk to a producer or someone of interest in the music industry every week while we drink some coffee. If you got the Dirty Bird coffee, even better, but any kind of coffee will do. And let's get into the show. We got some announcements before we get into our interview with our amazing friend Gene Ferris this week from Chicago. He's got the hottest new track on Dirty Bird. It's called Space Girl. It was just in that intro. If you didn't hear that, we will go into a clip of me playing it on the live stream from last week before we get into the interview. Just some announcements before we get going. Check out the Birdfeed subscription service. You can get 4 exclusive releases that you cannot find anywhere else, plus 3 months of Dirty Bird releases right now. There's a special deal going on. We're also planning a Minecraft special, Minecraft festival. So stay tuned for more info on that. Gene Ferris is confirmed to be playing there. So that's amazing. There's going to be lots of amazing guests on that, but we cannot say anything more. If you want to see some live music today, I will be playing on EDC's live stream tonight at 7:20 Pacific time. The set times are mad short, but I jammed in as many tracks as I could. Also, we have our typical usual Sunday live stream every week at 7 p.m. Pacific here, where I play like 2 hours and I play a lot of demos. We go through the demos that you cannot hear anywhere on the face of the earth. So that's really cool. So this week we're going to talk to Gene Ferris. He owns Ferris Wheel Recordings. He's from Chicago. We talk about what our kids are going to grow up like, as like, are they going to be DJs? We talk about making tracks. We talk about Star Wars. We talk about making tracks just for Dirty Bird and does that work or not. But first, let's watch a clip of me playing Space Girl from last week's live stream. And then we will get into our interview with Gene Ferris. And we'll be live chatting on Twitch the whole time. Hopefully Gene's on there. And we'll see you at the end.
Up into outer space. Far away from the human race. Different cosmos, another world. Can't you be my space girl?
There it is, the new track from Gene Ferris. It's called Space Girl. It's coming out right now on Dirty Bird. You got to go get it. Tell us about this track.
Woo, woo, woo.
That's it.
This track is my baby. And I have been trying to get a single on Dirty Bird for years. Like, I've done... you know, like the thing with me and Reva did, I believe that was the first thing I did with you guys, which did amazing. It was on you guys' 10
right.
compilation.
Yeah, that was really good.
Yeah, it did really well. And then me and Tim Baresco did the other thing on the other compilation.
Yep.
which was also
but there. You're like, no more compilation.
I was just like, you know what? Like, I was in London, and I started the track a bit here in Chicago, and I had the stems with me. I had it in my Dropbox, and I was in London, went in the studio, this big studio to work on that I go to, called Sutton House Studios out there. And I'm like, you know what? I want to do this song. So I didn't do the vocals yet, but I'm going to make it completely and totally for Dirty Bird. It's as you guys completely.
Usually that doesn't work. Usually people tell me that, and that usually when people tell me that, I hate the track. Wait, this time it worked. Yeah,
that usually from well, actually, I sent you three, and two of them you didn't like, so it's good.
No, but I mean, I don't mean like usually. I just mean usually when someone's like, "I made this track just for you," I always feel like they have like a bunch of farts out, like they have the wrong idea. But you got it
right. Yeah. Well, the thing is I've been kind of part of the family from afar for a long time, yeah, you know, absolutely. And I've been a fan of yours for a long time. And, you know, me and Justin are buddies, and me and Worthy are super good mates too. And Jay, you know, Jay Flip too. So, you know, I kind of think I somewhat got it, you know, I won't say I got it, but I kind of got it, you know, it took a while.
This record's coming out. I'm psyched about it. I mean, you know all about what's going on. You played Camp Out. You played all these parties with us.
Yeah, well, now I'm going to get my Dirty Bird tattoo. No. On my face, like Mike Tyson. No, don't do it. like I said before, I've been trying to get a single out with you guys forever, so I am honored to finally have one, and I have some, you know, the artwork from you guys that I can actually frame now because it's mine. I'm so happy, you know. I'm so honored to be a part of the family officially now. I love all you guys. I wish I had like a crowd of applause in the background sound. Crowd of applause, me like, hey. Maybe y'all can edit that in or something. I don't know, but I love you guys, you know, and thank you. What's up, my main man? How you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm good. Chilling in the windy. Not as warm as you guys, but we're doing okay.
I love Chicago. Even though I'm from Detroit, I love Chicago. I always have
What does that mean?
I have a joke that everyone from Detroit is a little sour and everyone from Chicago is really friendly and cool.
Oh, wow.
But I love Detroit, too. But, you know, the Chicago DJs are fun.
Well, we love you guys, too. We've always thought as you know, Detroit, you know, well, you know, for my upbringing, we always thought of you guys as like cousins. So, yeah. But again, you know, I am from the south side of Chicago.
Okay.
So we relate to Detroit a little bit more maybe than my Northside friends.
For people who don't know anything about Chicago, the south side of Chicago is a little more rough.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just put it mildly, I would say that for sure.
So
south side of Chicago is like it's like I guess downtown Detroit was about 10 years ago.
Right. Not anymore, I guess, right? Jeez.
No, it's changed a lot, which is really good for you guys, man.
Well, I'm not even out there anymore. I can't pretend I live in Detroit. I live in California where it's already like 90 degrees, so I'm not complaining about anything.
I was going to say, I can't feel bad for you guys at all out there. It's gorgeous.
Yeah. So, I mean, I feel like I've been doing this for a long time, but I didn't even have like a big track till 2005. You started your label in 1998. So how? You've been in the game for a real long time. How does it feel to it? You still love it though, right? I can tell you still do.
Yeah, I love it more now, to be honest with you. Barclay, Claude, I don't know what to call you in front of the people. It doesn't matter. I love it. I love it now more than I ever did. I started in the business, I was very, very young. You know, I don't want to go through my whole crazy backstory and stuff, but I was very young. I put out my first record with our mutual brother, our friend Curtis, put out my first record ever.
Like, when you say young, are you, like, in high school, or is it a little older than that?
I was probably, I dropped out of college after hearing my record, my first record on the radio when I was away at school in North Carolina.
Okay.
So I would say I was probably in my, like, 21, maybe 20, 21. I put out my first record.
What's the name of the first record?
The Ferris Wheel Project.
Okay. There you go. And your label is Ferris Wheel.
It's a funny story about that whole thing. It's like, you know, me and Curtis were sitting there. It's my first record. He was already like a rock star. Like, you know, he had Percolator out. He was already like, he was the same guy he is right now.
He started in 1990, right? Or like 89 or something?
As we say, there's OGs. I'm an OG. He's a double OG, you know? OG. And like, somebody like Pierre is like a triple OG, you know?
Right.
And Frankie Knuckles, God bless his, you know, rest his soul, and Ron Hardy, they're like, you know, they're like grand OGs.
Yeah.
Just, you know, can't get any bigger than that, you know? So he's been around forever. Like, he, it's you know, he's been in my life for so long. It's so funny. Like, you know, and I know he's an amazing good friend of yours, too. So,
yeah,
it's just awesome how things all kind of just come full circle through life, man.
It is. I've been to Chicago a bunch of times. I really love it there. It's just got a cool energy. It's a little bit
like... We love you, man. We love you here. We love you here so much. Like, they got a... I don't even know if you know, but you know, they got Chicago. They have a Dirty Bird... Chicago Dirty Birds page, which is...
Oh, really? Like a fan page.
Yeah, it's a fan page with all Chicago Dirty Bird people.
That's cool.
It's massive, man.
I always feel like when I go to Chicago... I have no idea what's going to happen. It feels like it's a little bit like wild, wild west, even though I live in the real west. There's something a little like, I don't know, something can always happen in Chicago. Like, it's a little crazy.
It's definitely on edge, you know what I mean? But I would say that as far as the clubs and the places that you and I DJ, everything's fine.
Yeah, you know, I don't mean crazy in a bad way. I mean crazy like... I don't know. I went some weird after parties.
it's definitely tripped out because the crowd is super educated. That's for sure.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes you'll look around and you'll see, you know, like I was just saying, you'll see legends just sitting around in the corner, kind of like, you know, checking you out, seeing what you're gonna do. It's definitely an intimidating city to DJ in. If you're from out of town, I would imagine, for sure. You know, I lived in Amsterdam for 4 years. And
oh, wow.
Like, yeah, for 4 years, from 2004 to 2008. I thought the world was going to end because George Bush's second term, it was over, man. Right. So I'm like,
that's
I'm
nothing.
Like, where can I go?
Had George Bush right now.
I would wish George Bush was in office right now. I would love him. I'd give him a big hug and everything and just be like, dude, you know, you're not so bad as I thought you were. Because right now, it's crazy. But I lived in Amsterdam for 4 years. And so every time I came back to do an America, you know, to in the States, my most intimidating gig was home. Was always Chicago.
Yeah.
It was always like, oh, man. Like,
I can really see that because... I feel that because, like, I know exactly what you mean. When I play in Detroit, there's a little bit more pressure. And even San Francisco, it's like that they're expecting, like, the legendary thing to happen that they've all hyped up in their minds or whatever. So, yeah, I get it. It's like always, and all your friends are there, and they get, like, my parents come to sets and stuff. It's, like, crazy.
Yeah. Man, I met your parents at Movement. I was like, I can't believe Claude brought his mom and dad out. That's so cool. Like, I met them at Movement.
They love going.
They were so cool, though. It was so, like, chill.
That's great. I'm glad you met them.
Yeah, it was beautiful, man. It was when you and Curtis were doing a tag set.
Oh, yeah.
And your parents were there backstage, and I was backstage with Bruce just hanging out, goofing right. around. And Bruce like, yo, this is Barclay's parents, right? I'm like, no, you know, straightened up, got my shit together real quick. And
Bruce is working. Bruce works at, he's a label manager over there, and he's got a bunch of twins. And we both have kids, and how is your little one doing?
Oh, yeah, he's great. I have two. Like, I have...
I don't know anything.
No, I have a six-year-old. He's from a previous relationship, and then me and my wife have our young little one, Roland.
Right. Roland. Okay. That's cool.
Yep, kind of tried to slide that in there. But, he's awesome. He's a handful. He's, you know, I say one of them is going to be the promoter, and the other one's going to probably be the DJ.
I wish I could get my kids into it. I don't know if they're going to do it or not.
You know, it's one of those things, isn't it? Like, you know, I think about it all the time. Like, they're probably going to think we're nerds. It's going to think it's the worst thing. So my nightmare is going to happen. Well, at least my nightmare would be is my son ends up being like a hip-hop DJ right. playing in some... You know, opening up for Drake, like the Drake's opening DJ, he's touring right. all over. That's a nightmare for me, okay? But that's probably exactly what's going to happen because, like, you know, he's not going to play what dad plays.
Don't you think that maybe they might just be like, I'm going completely opposite. I'm going to be an accountant. like I'm going to be a scientist or something.
That's what we hope for, right? That's what I hope for. But we know it's like once they figure out they got like the keys to the club and every club in the world,
yeah, it's over.
Our kids, you know, they'd be like, oh, that's Barclay's son and Gene Francis' kid hanging out over there at the bar. Like they're not going to like ever be able to pay for a club. They're never going to have to pay for a drink, you know. Eventually they're going to get roped in somehow.
I can't even imagine growing up like that. That's crazy.
It's insane. You know, the funny thing is, you know, my mom, you know, my dad passed away when I was really young, so he never really got to see this whole part of my life. Oh, but my mom, no, it's all right, man. It's all right. Like, he was, you know, my mom, you know, is older. You know, I'm the youngest of three. And she never remarried or anything, so he's the only dad I ever knew, and he passed away like 2 weeks before my 10th birthday, but wow. I remember him. He was great. He was an awesome guy, but I want to get more of it. You know, I'm old now. It's been a long time, so it's okay. But my mom, she's the only one who was, like, truly, like, supportive of what I was doing. You know, I have an older brother and an older sister. Like, I remember like,
making music.
Yeah, I'm the baby. I'm the baby of three. And my older sister used to come up and like turn that shit off. I want to hear that music. It's too loud. My brother, I remember when I first started making music when I was like 17. I'm in my bedroom rocking on this track, and I swear that to this day, Barclay, to this day, this is the best track I've ever made. Right, 17, and he flicks the circuit breakers off, like boom, like cuts the power off because the music is too loud. And back then, everything was MIDI, right?
There's no preset saving and all the...
No, there's no alternative back on. Autosave's going to make it out. It's cool. No, those days were like, you know, hadn't even been thought of yet. It's like, once you flick off your MIDI stuff, that's it.
Yeah.
So, that's you know, depressing. I remember it was tough in the beginning, you know, and now, you know, my family's my biggest supporters. My sister's a cop and my brother's a doctor. And
I met your wife at shows before as well.
Yeah, she's really cool. She watches, you know, she's watches special needs children for a living. So,
oh, that's great.
Everybody has pretty much a humble job except me, I guess. You know,
but they keep you in check at home. I bet, like, they definitely don't
Oh, they keep me in super check. I am not DJ anybody at home. I'm just dad or that dude.
Yes, exactly. So I was just looking over your, like, discography and everything. You got 7 albums. That is crazy.
God, man, I feel like an old man.
It's cool.
This is like...
I mean... That's good.
No,
you seem to be making a lot of tracks, and what I noticed over like the last, I don't know, maybe 4 or 5 years is when your stuff is like sounds really good. Like the EQ and like the mix downs are like really on point. Like everything is super tight in that area.
Well, coming from you, that is like the biggest compliment I could ever get. You know, most of us when we go in the studio, we always have reference tracks.
Yeah.
You know, like, okay, this is the bar of how I want my stuff to sound. And it's always your stuff, Curtis.
That's great.
Or Chris Lake.
Oh, yeah.
Every time. Like, okay, these are the bars of where right. I'm trying to get to. So
I forgot about doing like that. I gotta start doing that again. It is really helpful for everybody out there to put a reference track on the top track or wherever, and just kind of gauge where you're at in the mix. And it's
absolutely
really helpful, yeah.
Absolutely. You know, and I remember like before that, before you had computer abilities to have a reference track. My reference tracks, everything I was doing or listening to or trying to emulate was, my idol is Little Louis. Like,
oh, yeah.
He's my hero. Like, he's the person that the first person I seen ever DJ in front of, 1,000 people. And it blew my mind as a teenager. I'm like, man, how can I get from, being a neighborhood DJ, the dude yeah. is DJing at, the family reunion and block club if I'm lucky, to that, he was always my bar, sound quality, entertainer wise. I loved him. Like I thought he was just like a superhero.
Yeah. I mean, you're really lucky because if you think about it, you got to see that, and that was an inspiration to you. So you actually conceived of that as an actual job that you could maybe do. Just yeah. imagine if you're growing up in like Indiana or like Utah, and there is no Lil Louis playing in the bar down the street. It's like way harder jump to
yeah.
think of, hey, I'm going to be a professional DJ, which is why I think so many people come out of Chicago and so many people come out of Detroit. It's because there's like a hierarchy of people who came before that you can
yeah.
look at and say, oh, that's a real job that like I could go be a lawyer or I could go be a DJ because that's a job in this
right. city. You have an inspiration that's right in front of you that you can see.
Yeah.
And that's why I tip my hat off to, I can't do it right now because I haven't had a haircut in a couple of months, but
yeah.
I tip my hat to people like, Nicole Mortebear. She's from Beirut, man.
Yeah,
like,
it was amazing.
I mean, you come from, how do you come from that and you find this? And then, their world, her world is intertwined now into our world. It's just a beautiful thing,
yeah,
Cool. It's awesome, man. Like
the internet has really changed it a lot, so you can see people
yes.
do it.
Yes,
like
absolutely.
You can see us chatting. You can see live streams. You just did a live stream. We're doing them all the time. Like you can see that it is a thing now. Before when we were starting, I couldn't even get a magazine about like how to get a turntable that would scratch. there's nothing.
Yeah, it's completely, things have changed so much, right, since back in the day. Like, I think about it, I've lived through a lot of, I started DJing, I would say, professionally. I won't say professionally, but getting some kind of wages, as they would say in the UK, for DJing, was like 1990. And I've watched the music go from, all black guys in the club, to, only vinyl to, now it's like
right.
CDJs if you're lucky.
Right.
And like, there's no vinyl really to be seen anymore.
That's
and like,
true.
Club is all mixed with colors of people. And, you know, in the beginning, it was, you know, if you were lucky, like, we used to do these underground warehouse parties in Chicago. I used to do a lot of them on this street called Milwaukee Avenue. And it was illegal parties, obviously. They start around 11 o'clock. We bring in nitrous tanks.
Yeah.
A bunch of people come in.
This is like the first, you know, party that I ever went to. It looked exactly like this.
Yeah, yes. Yeah,
it's tanks and water. No drinks.
That's it. Well, we had a bar, but we had our own bar that we you know, set up like a keg, and then we'd have like, you know, a few gallons of vodka and stuff to give to the few hundred people that were there. And you know, I think about like how it was that with 200, you know, 100, 200 people, you were happy to now. I mean, man, like we're playing festivals with,
I know, it doesn't make
15,000-20,000 people, man. And like,
Curtis and I would joke, like, not this year, but last year, we'd just be like, what happened? Like, all these kids are into this music now. It was really unexpected. It really blew up in like the last 4 years, 5 years, maybe, like to a whole nother level.
Amazing, man. It's what I dreamed about when I was a kid listening to Lil Lewis times 10.
Yeah.
You know, and it's like, you know, to go back to the beginning, you know, what we were talking about is I'm more in love with this than I ever have been in my life at the moment. Making music right now is a joy, you know. I know a lot of my friends have been having like problems during the pandemic and stuff, being able to write and having writer's block, but it hasn't really hit for me. Thank goodness.
Yeah, I've been in the studio.
I was in the studio, Barclay, every day anyway.
Yeah.
So when this, you know, except when I'm on the weekends, I get on the plane. My routine is usually like this. I wake up, I watch my son until my wife gets home from work. I give her a kiss. We may have some food. I'm out the door. I'm in the studio till, you know, 11, 12 o'clock at night. I'm home, rinse and repeat. Then on the weekends, I get on the plane, do my thing, do my shows. If I have to tour like Australia or something for a month, that may be a little bit different than I'm not in the studio because I can't work on my laptop. I'm not one of those laptop people.
I don't know why that is. I can't do it at all.
I can make a sketch in
like an iPad for 5 minutes, but I can't like make a track, finish a track.
I can't focus. Yeah. I can't focus on it. Like, I wish I could pan the camera around because I'm sitting in my studio now and I would show you.
Yeah.
This is my home. Like, this is my
at the end, you should show us if you can, if you can walk around with it.
I wish I could. I'm probably at the end. I'll risk it. I won't risk it right now.
Some fan questions. We're just going to do a few of them. Okay. What unique part of Chicago stands out from other house scenes like Detroit or SF? We kind of went over that a little bit.
What unique sounds? I would say what's really unique in Chicago is that we have a massive, still old school scene here, which is, you know, like we said, triple OG scene. Yeah. You know, but the chosen few guys,
right?
Some of my great friends, Terry Hunter, Alan King, Andre Hatchett, another dude who I grew up listening to. My God, I grew up listening to all these guys, actually.
Yeah.
Wayne Williams, these guys.
Paul Johnson.
Jesse Saunders. My God. Like, you know, these guys from the chosen few are like the dudes who are the kings of the old school scene. You know, if they have a fest, they have their own festival here, which they have like 30,000-40,000 people.
Wow. That's amazing. Yeah,
it's massive. It's huge. It's massive, man. People bring out tents. They have their grills. They got their stage. It's only disco, man.
Wow.
It's only old school disco.
That sounds like a party. I would love to see that.
Yeah, Frankie Knuckles played there. I remember one year me and Curtis went, we just, you know, snuck in there and we just, you know, it's all black people, so we just kind of blended right in.
That's
so
awesome.
And they were like, what are you two dudes doing in here? You know, like, Wow. Mr. Tech House himself. No.
All right, I got another question that's kind of funny. How do you feel when shufflers dance to your songs?
Wow. You know, funny being, I'm working on a song right now called Footwork.
Okay, good.
I don't, you know, it doesn't bother me if they're good.
Yeah.
That's the key. They have to be really good at their craft. Okay.
We had like, a funny, go ahead, finish your part.
No, I was going to say, I can enjoy anything, well, most anything, if someone's good at their craft. Okay. Yeah. Like, I'm not a fan, personally, of classical music or, you know, deep country music. But yeah. If it's presented well, like Sweet Home Alabama or Beethoven's Fifth,
yeah,
then I love it. You know, that's my point. Okay. So it's all about the presentation, I think.
We had this, we did one season of Dirty Bird in Ibiza one year. It was it was a struggle. this girl, Chloe, who was kind of like our ear on the street, she would come in to me every night. She'd be like, oh, mate, your party, it's going to get ruined because the fucking shufflers are coming in. The fucking shufflers are coming in. Your party's going to get ruined. She had this really thick English accent that I can't do. But anyway, that was like 8 years ago. At least.
Wow.
But I don't have anything against it. Like, people are having fun, then they're having fun.
Yeah, well, you know, and like I said, it's a good shuffler and it's a bad shuffler. Like,
I think the bad shuffler is even funnier.
Well, a bad shuffler? I was going to say, I'm going to give you a moment so you're
going to go in the corner.
Right. If you're a bad shuffler, you know, and then have you ever seen the Chicago shufflers?
Oh, I mean, I've seen Footwork. Like Chicago Ooh. Kings and all these guys.
Yeah, that's the original. Amazing. That's the OGs right there. Yeah, that's the OGs shuffling, man. Like,
yeah,
those are, you know, when I see people put up shuffle videos, I'm like, you know, that's cool, but you all really need to check out the Chicago shuffle. And like, a lot of the young kids don't even know what that is.
I mean, it is so far beyond what people can imagine, the quality and like the level of skill.
Oh, banging.
What was that guy?
Banging, man. It's someone like, it's like its own thing, you know?
I'm trying to think of the names of those guys, but I watch those videos all the time. I love it.
Well, we call it footwork.
Yeah, too. I know. The footwork. Yeah. Kids, but there's like, there's like the Chicago Kings have this whole like YouTube. And they're so ridiculous. And they show you the moves and you're just like, I'm never doing that. I can't even see his feet. I can't even see his feet. They're going so fast.
I'm gonna pull something. I'm gonna tear something trying to do that.
All right. What's your opinion of California festival scene, especially the smaller ones?
You know what, man? I'm gonna confess something right now that only my closest friends know. If there was anywhere else in the world I would live, it would be California. That's nice. And I'm in love specifically with San Diego. I love San Diego so much.
Okay, cool.
That's my thing. And I love San Francisco too. Come on, like I'm always there. You know, and I've been partying in San Francisco since was it Folsom? 300 West Folsom and what was it? I've been coming there for years.
Oh, 1015 yeah. Folsom.
1015
yeah,
Folsom.
Yeah.
Way back in the day of Anyo and what's the other dude's Garth?
Garth and Yano from Garth from Yano, Greyhound or Wicked. Yeah. The Wicked crew. Yeah,
the Wicked parties. Those are the ones.
Yeah. They're Wicked, Green Gorilla, Sunset. These are all these crews. It. Moon Tribe, like. Yeah, man. It's a scene.
Those are my boys, dude. Like, so I've been partying in California for, oh God, man, 25 years, man. Like, wow. I love it there. So, I love the festivals there. I love the festivals there. You all know that. I'm always out there.
Yeah, I know.
I love it there. Some of my favorite festivals in California. Oh man, it's you know, obviously, you know, not to just, I would say this if you weren't here, you know, some of the coolest things I've done in California were your shows that you've invited me to, which was really awesome.
Or the barbecues, yeah. I don't even know. Yeah, you were at Camp Out, and maybe you did a barbecue in Brooklyn with us.
Yeah, that was off the chain.
Yeah, that was cool.
Was crazy. That was pretty nuts. That was pretty nuts. Yeah, obviously, I can't remember a lot of names offhand. You know, obviously, I played the, I can't remember a lot of the names of the festivals, and that means I've been playing a lot there. So
yeah, I can't remember.
I have nothing but love and nothing but respect for California's scene all in general. The only thing I don't like is that the liquor stops at 2.
Oh,
I don't
even drink.
I don't even drink alcohol.
This I don't drink anymore either, but I don't like that either. It's bad for the party.
Yeah, the liquor stops at 2, and the party keeps going to 4.
Yeah.
It's like, the liquor's going to stop at 2, you might as well just stop the
it's
party.
It's demotivating as a DJ because it doesn't matter if you're like Jesus Christ DJing.
Yeah, they're gone, like, man.
They're gone by 3:30. Yeah. No matter what, it's over by 3:30.
Yeah, I make
and
sure
maybe
that
by
anytime
3,
I play
you still got some
in California, I get the 12 to 2 slot.
Yeah, right. You don't want the 2 to 4 slot because
that's like be hanging out with the bar back.
We're going back. So last question: what's up with all the Star Wars stuff?
Oh man, yeah, I got a bit of addiction. It's pretty bad, you know. Again, I wish I could show you all the stuff. I got things hanging from the ceiling, but
wait, I got something.
Hold on. Oh, let's see. Got a couple of things here that I can pull up really quick.
The Destroyer.
Couple of ships there. Can you see those things?
Yeah.
A couple of Star Destroyers. There's a few more hanging from the ceiling up there. What else do we got?
I got the same problem with comic, like 80s comic books.
Oh, wait. I got to introduce you to my dog, Chewy, too. Hold on. Okay.
Does he make the sound?
Roof, roof.
It's an addit. Wow, that's a big toy. Is that even considered at that size? Is that even considered a toy, or is that just considered like a sculpture?
Which one is it?
The addit. I mean, it's not even a toy anymore at that size. It's like a sculpture, right?
Yeah. Well, that's one of the original ones from the first one.
Oh yeah.
So he's barely hanging on. Like, he's gone through like young gene to teenage gene to college gene. Wow. So there's weed smoke all over him. He's a bit sticky. He's got all kinds of stuff on him.
If he can only talk.
Yeah, this is a Bluetooth, believe it or not. Whoa. Bluetooth speaker.
Wow.
So yeah, it's pretty bad.
All right.
At the end of this whole thing, I'll give you a whole thing, a whole studio on the walls and stuff. You can see everything.
Thank you for being on the show. It's awesome.
Man, thank you for having me, man. Like, you know, you got the three coverage. You're a cool guy.
Thank you.
You're a legend. And you're a friend.
Thank you so very much. You're a cool guy, legend, and a friend as well.